I'd like to start by telling you something about myself that doesn't appear in my official bio. Because while it's true that I lead NASA scientific missions and oversee MIT's plan for action on climate change, those things don't begin to tell my whole story. Before I became a planetary scientist and mapped the gravity fields of the moon, Mars, and other planets, I was a girl growing up in coal country in eastern Pennsylvania. Both my grandfathers were coal miners. The burning of a fossil fuel, anthracite coal, was the foundation of the community and the way of life where I grew up. Since the 1800s, scientists had theorized that burning fossil fuels would make CO2 build up in our atmosphere and cause the planet to warm. But it was only around that time that I went off to college and the pace of that buildup really took off. If humanity remains on its current path and carbon dioxide keeps accumulating, the effects will be severe. Sea levels will rise dramatically, inundating the world's coastal cities. Widespread crop failures will occur as vast areas of land can no longer support agriculture, resulting in food shortages. Countless species of animals and plants will become extinct because they cannot adapt in the face of rapidly changing conditions. And millions of people around the world will leave their uninhabitable regions and become climate refugees, relying on people in other regions to take them in. But this doesn't have to happen. Our past is full of scientific and technological breakthroughs that have changed our species' course and changed countless lives for the better. Our future can be like this as well. So even though climate change is real, is here now, and is threatening to become much worse, I'm optimistic because MIT is helping to change the course we find ourselves on. MIT can truly help create a better world. I want to tell you about three areas for technological development where there is real need, real promise, and real reason for hope. Let's begin with batteries. Batteries store energy that charges our cell phones, starts our cars, plays our music, and powers many activities modern life depends on. What you may not know is that batteries will play a major role in slowing down climate change. Right now, most of the world's electricity still comes from burning fossil fuels, including coal. Improved battery storage technology is one key to replacing carbon-emitting fossil fuels with clean, renewable solar and wind energy. The biggest limitation on greater deployment of renewables is their intermittency. That's why we're working on ways to store solar energy so we can use it when the sun isn't shining, and to store wind energy when the wind isn't blowing. Over the coming years, we need to make advances in battery design, capacity, and efficiency to hasten the transition to a clean energy future. We also need to develop ways to produce batteries using more common and less expensive materials. MIT is all over this. Next, carbon capture. We know that burning fossil fuels releases carbon dioxide molecules that then persist in our atmosphere for about 1,000 years or more, preventing heat from escaping in what we call the greenhouse effect. What if we had a way of catching the CO2 so it didn't stay in the atmosphere and hold the Earth's heat? That could happen at the source of the CO2 emissions, like the way industrial scrubbers remove pollutants before they go up a factory smokestack. Or it could happen afterwards, perhaps taking the carbon out of the atmosphere the way a vacuum cleaner pulls dirt out of a rug. We don't know how to do this cost effectively yet, and we also don't know what we do with all the CO2 if we manage to corral it. But carbon capture could be a big part of the climate change solution, and we're on this one as well. Third, fusion. Nuclear fusion is, quite simply, the process the sun and other stars use to create energy all the warmth and light we receive from the sun is the result of fusion. The challenge for us is to put this process to work here on Earth. People used to laugh when I talked about fusion, but they're not laughing anymore. There are difficult problems to solve to enable the production of fusion energy at a cost and scale that are practical to address our energy needs. Our basic challenge is how to generate the intense heat needed to fuse hydrogen atoms without expending more energy to generate that heat than the energy you end up producing. But if we can crack this problem, and it's looking more and more like we soon will, that would change everything. The key ingredient for fusion energy, hydrogen, is essentially both free and inexhaustible. And fusion energy emits no CO2 and produces no radioactive waste. Batteries, carbon capture, fusion. They offer the promise of heading off the catastrophic changes in store for our world if we continue on our current course. But, and this is important, these technologies are not going to invent, refine, and scale up themselves. Investments are needed, long-term investments, by governments, companies, and philanthropists, in partnership with scientists and engineers and entrepreneurs. MIT has work underway in each of these areas, most notably in fusion, where more than $200 million have already been invested in an MIT spin-off, Commonwealth Fusion Systems. MIT isn't going to solve climate change by itself, but we do need to commit to solving this problem, and then we need to do it. And that includes making the investments necessary to make our planet sustainable. I want to leave you with this last image. It was taken from the Apollo 8 spacecraft in lunar orbit half a century ago on Christmas Eve, when I was still growing up back in eastern Pennsylvania. Less than a year later, humans stepped onto the moon's surface for the first time. When this image was taken, countries around the world were fighting wars, experiencing racial strife, intergenerational tension, economic uncertainties, and political turmoil. Sound familiar? And still, we did this. Everything we humans have ever done and known and loved has taken place on that beautiful small blue planet. Our species did not summon all that it took to get to the moon and back, only to diminish the Earth that we will pass on to our children and to future generations. In our own troubled times, I hope we can draw inspiration from what human ingenuity and determination achieved not so long ago, and that we seize the moment to make all the investments required to enable those who came after us to do great things we can't even imagine. Thank you.